him, declare it to him today. Say, God, if it wasn't for your grace, we'd be lost without you. All over the sanctuary. Come on, lift your hands and your voices to Jesus and say it.
Praise the name of Jesus.
Now come on, if he's your rock, tell him he's your rock.
He's my rock.
He's my what?
He's my fortress.
He's my deliverer.
He's my deliverer.
Lift our hands up in the air. Come on, tell him something sweet today. Come on, open your mouth and declare to him that he's good. Declare to him that he's God. Come on, tell him how much that you love him. There's no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. Come on, open your mouth all over the building. No sweeter name. Hallelujah. God, you're wonderful today. God, we stand in awe and expectation of you today. Father, we're believing you for great and mighty things, and your word decrees and declares that if we would call upon your name, that you would do something great, something mighty, something unknown to us. So we stand in your presence today, and we cry and call on the name of Jesus, for there's no other name under heaven by which men can be saved. So we call on Jesus today. Come on, can anybody call on the name of Jesus today? Does anybody know that there's power in the name of Jesus? There's deliverance in the name of Jesus. Your healing is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough is in the name of Jesus. Transformation is in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. Come on, lift that up with us today. Say it.
No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known.
No,
no sweeter name than the name.
You are the light to my heart.
you're the greatest name that we know. So we cry on your name and we say, hallelujah. God, we cry out for you today. That's all we're saying. Can you help us lift that up and say it? Come on, break the music, just voices. Come on, everybody, lift that up in the sanctuary. Say it. Jesus. Come on, cry out to our great God today. Come on, can we lift that up one more time? Say it all together. Jesus. Together some more. Say it. Come on, call on his great name today. Call on his great name today. Call on him. Come on, just a little bit louder. Cry out. Come on, let's cry out for him today. Cry out for him in the room.
Anybody love him today? Call him. Hallelujah. Oh, my. Hallelujah. Would you join hands with that person beside you as we call on that name? God, into your presence, we thank you that where two or three are gathered, touching or agreeing. In your name, you promised to be in our midst. Now we've called you, we've prayed, we've desired, we have corporately and individually made known our dependence upon thee. Now, God, in this worship service, as we call upon your name, as you are the center of attraction, as we've worshiped you in spirit and in truth, as we've prioritized you and thee alone, now would you speak to our hearts? We know, oh God, that in your presence there's fullness of joy. Thank you for this fifth Sunday. Thank you for this college student service. We thank you for these young people who've not forsaken you in their youth, but even while matriculating in college, they have prioritized thee. Now, oh God, as we have come to highlight them and to allow them to share, now would you speak to all of us, regardless of race, status, or place in life, we need to hear from you. Have your way in this place. Every hand that is held, every life, every home that is represented, get the glory, God. Somebody needs to hear from you today. Speak in this place like you've never spoken before. And we give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. Now, every hand we touch, we decree today. We pray that we stand in unity And oh God, we are expecting great things that are yet on the way. In the name of Jesus, we love you and we bless you. Amen. Amen. Let's give God praise, would you? Praise the Lord. Listen, I am so glad to be here today on the fifth Sunday. You may be seeing the presence of the Lord. It's been a great weekend. Friday and Saturday, our children and our teens have been involved in athletic ministry, and we thank God for them, all of our teams who participate in the Christian Basketball League all day on yesterday. Amen. This morning, we had our children's choir to bless us. Amen. They blessed us this morning. Had some of our college student representatives blessed us, college student praise team, India with the Mime dance. Thank God for them, Mime ministry. So awesome, such a blessing. And everybody's here today. I see so many people representing their colleges and representing their sororities or their fraternities. I want everybody who's dressed today in your paraphernalia of your college or your sorority, your fraternity. One brother said, Pastor, when I arrived, he said, I didn't wear anything because they didn't have any paraphernalia for the alternative school. So I said, okay, we on. Amen. So I guess, so I want everybody else who's dressed in your college attire, your fraternity, your sorority attire, would you stand and represent your particular institution this morning? Would you do that? Would you do that? I'm representing the greatest institution on earth other than the church. Just give them all a hand, all the different colleges. Wow. We're going to have a little fun at the end with the different ones, but I'm excited to see you now. Amen. And we're excited. Our singles are getting ready to do something next Sunday. I think they're having a Super Bowl party. I think so. We're going to talk more about that. So we're just not one church. We don't just say we're one church ministering to four generations. We are literally one church that has a passion for reaching every segment of our congregation. And I'm excited about that we've come from the children this morning, youth yesterday, college students today. We got a real good meal for all of our college students after service. We're going to feed them today. Amen. We want them to have the ID. We're going to feed them today with your college ID. Amen. Yes. And if you've been in school consecutively for longer than 7 years, we don't consider you a college student. Amen. You are grown. Amen. Unless you've been part-time. We're excited. This morning, you know, I'm back in school, myself in school all week, finishing up my doctoral studies. Y'all pray for a brother. Pray hard for a brother. Amen. I am too old for this. Amen. And we're excited. We have a young man today who has been preaching. Preaching is in his bones. His father was a graduate of Bishop College, one of the leading colleges for African-American preachers from the 50s all up to the mid-80s until its unfortunate closing. He lived in San Diego, California, there with his father prior to moving to Huntsville, Alabama to matriculate at the Alabama A&M, while he was an athlete and a part of the gospel choir there. He's been a part of our church since that choir would come and worship with us during their spring break here in Bobby Hampton. And he's recently moved here a couple of years ago, and I just admire him so much. He's such an humble, down-to-earth, gifted brother. And we have so many talented men and women who preach the Word of God here, and we want to help expose and develop even more of that talent. So this morning, the Lord told me, said, give him the book. And we're going to give him the book this morning to come and break unto us God's unsearchable riches. His name is Minister Kristian Smith. He's been through a whole lot recently. What I love about him is you would never know he was a preacher if you didn't ask him. Amen. Because he doesn't carry himself that way. But he is gifted to preach. I want you to prepare to receive him. He's going to bring our message this morning. I want you to elevate your right hand and repeat after me. Minister Smith, we need a word from the Lord. Greater Travels Rest, Minister Kristian Smith. Minister Kristian Smith, Greater Travels Rest. Give him a hand as he comes to bless us this morning.
praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. First of all, I give honor to God, who is the reason that I am here, the reason I have breath in my body. And I thank him for this opportunity. I also honor my pastor, Pastor E. Dewey Smith. Can you give our pastor a hand, please? Amen. There were many people he could have chosen this morning. He could have preached himself. You know, he don't need a whole lot of time to prepare. He can get up here and preach whenever he gets ready. But I thank God that he allowed me this opportunity. And I appreciate the opportunity and I understand the responsibility. For everyone who is disappointed right now because your pastor's not preaching, trust me, I understand. I've been where you are. But if you'll bear with me for a few moments, I believe God has a word that will bless all of us. Amen. I want to get straight into God's word, but first I have to acknowledge my wife, who is my best friend, my biggest supporter, Miss Amber Patrice Smith. Will you please stand up? And the rest of my family that came to support me today, will you stand up with her? All of my family that came to support today, everybody stand up. Amen. Thank God for my entire family that's here today. Good to see my sister and my brother and my mother today. Amen. So glad to see everybody. I want to go ahead and get straight into God's word. If you have your Bibles, will you open them with me to the Gospel according to Mark? The Gospel according to Mark, the third chapter. Mark, the third chapter. We want to start at verse 1. We're going to be reading today from the King James Version. Once again, that's the Gospel according to Mark, the book of Mark, the third chapter, the first through the fifth verse. Mark chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 reads, "And he entered again into the synagogue. And there was a man there which had a withered hand, and they watched him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, Stand forth. And he saith unto them, Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath day or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they held their peace. And when he had looked round about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, Stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other." Amen. You may have your seats. Just for a few moments, I want to raise this thought, the perfect setup. The perfect setup. Amen. Turn to your neighbor real quick, look at him dead in the eye and say, "Neighbor, this morning, the preacher is going to talk about the perfect setup." Amen. Will you just bow your heads with me briefly for a word of prayer? God, I come to you right now acknowledging who you are. God, I understand that you are on the throne. You are God and God alone. You are sovereign. You are in control, and you don't need anybody's help. God, I come to you right now asking you to perfect your strength in my weakness. Because, God, right now I am weak, but I understand that my weakness only gives you room to exhibit your strength. So, God, show yourself strong right now on my behalf. Show yourself strong on my behalf right now, dear Heavenly Father. I pray for phenomenal preaching power right now in the name of Jesus. God, have your way in this place. God, whatever you deem to be necessary, God, you do it right now in the name of Jesus. God, if someone needs healing, I ask that you would heal, God, salvation, deliverance, whatever your people stand in the need of, God, I ask right now that you would do it in the name of Jesus, God. I give you all the glory It's not about me today, God, but it's about all of you. It's about you getting the glory today, God. So receive it right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. The perfect setup. The perfect setup. The Bible tells us in Genesis 1 that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And in the subsequent verses, he went on to create mankind. And he gave mankind, Adam and Eve, dominion over the Garden of Eden. And he only gave them one rule. He said, don't eat from that particular tree. And this was a simple rule, but in came the enemy. And the enemy exploited mankind's carnality. And after he exploited mankind's carnality, Adam and Eve ate from this tree that they were commanded not to eat from. Now, it would appear to me that a travesty such as this should have thrown a monkey wrench in God's plans. But actually, he used mankind's carnality as a perfect setup for his covenant. For he chose his people, the children of Israel, and he made a covenant with these people. And it was very simple. He said, if you will be my people, I will be your God. It seems simple enough. If you will be my people, I will be your God. But we were a hard-headed people. And I don't just think the children of Israel were hard-headed, but I think that speaks about us as well. Sometimes we can be a hard-headed people, and sometimes we didn't act as if we were his people. Once again, this could have messed up his plans, but rather he used our hard-headedness as a result of his covenant to be the perfect setup for the advent of Jesus the Christ. Yes, sir. And it was the life and the ministry of Jesus Christ that was a perfect setup for the cross and Calvary. But how many of you know that even the crucifixion was a setup? That Friday evening crucifixion was only a setup for Sunday morning's wake-up call. And right now, he is sitting at the right hand of God the Father in heaven, and we are now awaiting his comeback so that we'll be caught up. And it is amazing to me how God can orchestrate and maneuver on such a universal level, how he can strategically set things in place on such a global level, from creation to carnality to the covenant to Christ. The cross, Calvary, crucifixion, his comeback, our confession and being caught up. He can maneuver on such a universal level. We used to sing a song when I was a little boy. It said, he's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. But what is amazing to me that while his hands are big enough to grasp the whole world, the song also says, he's got my mama and my daddy in his hands. He's got my brother and my sister in his hands. So while he is a big picture God, he also takes the time to look into the details of our very lives. And God can take unfavorable conditions and circumstances and use them to set us up for a breakthrough. He can take hell on the job. He can take a broken marriage. He can take anything that is hindering us and use it to set us up for breakthroughs. Use it to set us up for miracles. Use it to set us up for blessings. And what I see in the text today is the perfect setup. God is taking circumstances. He is taking people's motives. He is taking whatever may come and using it to set up his people for blessings. And I believe that somebody in here is being set up today. I believe I'm not the only one who's being set up, but there's somebody else who should be able to testify with me. I'm being set up because I'm going through some stuff at home. I'm going through some stuff on the job. I'm even going through some stuff in my church. I'm going through some stuff in my college classes. My professor's acting crazy, but God is just setting us up to bless us. Can you just walk through this text with me? I promise you I won't be in your way too long. It says here in Mark chapter 3, verse 1, look, it says, and he, being Jesus, entered again into the synagogue. And there was a man there which had a withered hand. First of all, notice the first point in the setup. Notice the saints' meeting place. Somebody say the saints' meeting place.
says, and he entered again into the synagogue. Jesus goes to church. Get out of here. Even Jesus understood a need to go to church. And that's the first part of the setup. Jesus was in church. And not only was Jesus in church, look, it says, and there was a man there which had a withered hand, the man with the infirmity, the man with the problem in his life. This particular man showed up to church. You can't miss the meeting place. That's the first part of your setup. See, you got to be in the right place at the right time. You got to be where God is going to be to distribute his blessings. Don't miss the meeting place. Now, yes, this man did have problems. He had a withered hand. He had problems in his life. And what amazes me is that in our modern day, people, when they have problems, don't come to church. That is so oxymoronic to me that you would have problems in your life and get further away from Jesus. But Isaiah said it was in the year that King Uzziah died. It was at that time I saw the Lord high and lifted up. Where did I see him? In the temple. So it was at a time in Isaiah's life where he had lost someone that was close to him. He was at a time in his life where he was grieving, he was mourning, and he said, it was at that time I saw the Lord. It was at that time I got closer to the Lord. You know what's amazing to me about that text? He said it was at a time that King Uzziah died. But what's amazing is that royalty did not have temple funerals. He said, I saw the Lord in the temple at the time King Uzziah died, but royalty had funerals at the palace. So Isaiah said, while everybody else was concerned with palace platitudes, I made my way to the temple to see my master. Don't miss the meeting place. Don't miss the meeting place. Are you going to help me today? Pastor already mentioned that I played football at Alabama A&M University, and I started in 02, I finished in 06. And when I came in 02, there were 33 people in my recruiting class. We came in gung-ho, ready to go. And by the time I finished in 2006, three of us remained. Over the course of my career, we went from 33 to 3. That's amazing to me. And over the course of my career, there were many people who came on and jumped off. People were kicked off the team, let go. They decided to give up, figured out college football wasn't for them, whatever it may be. But there was something I found out about my time playing college football. We weren't always informed if someone was no longer on the team. Coach didn't come to us in a meeting and say, I want y'all to know such and such is not.